Good evening. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. I was really delighted when the 92nd Street Y invited me to moderate this event, not only because I'm a huge fan of both Mary Karr and Helen Macdonald, but also because I thought it was a really brilliant pairing. These are two writers who are exceptionally different on the page, yet have both chosen to devote their considerable talents sometimes to memoir and sometimes to poetry, which is actually quite an unusual crossover among writers and one that I personally find very interesting. Like basically everyone who has ever picked up one of Mary Karr's memoirs, I adore them for their candor and their dark comedy and for how vividly she illuminates both her own internal universe and the external circumstances that have shaped it. But I also really admire her poems, and as I was thinking about what I wanted to say tonight, I found that my mind kept turning to poetry, and in particular to some lines I really love by Gerard Manley Hopkins, which I'm going to share with you tonight because they're relevant and much more beautiful than anything I myself could ever come up with to say about the project of expressing oneself, which is a lot of what we're going to be talking about here. These lines are from the poem As Kingfishers Catch Fire. Hopkins writes, "Each mortal thing does one thing and the same, deals out that being indoors each one dwells, selves, goes itself, myself it speaks and spells, crying, what I do is me, for that I came." What I love most about those lines is the way Hopkins turns self into a verb. It is what we are always doing all the time, articulating ourselves intentionally and otherwise in our every word and deed. And what I love about Mary Karr is how deliberately she has selved, how in three memoirs and four volumes of poetry, she has shared her inmost self insightfully and wittily and unsparingly with the rest of us. Like Hopkins, Mary is a devout Catholic, and her second book, Lit, I should say her second memoir, Lit, is an example of perhaps that oldest form of memoir, a conversion story. And although they ultimately sound extremely different, she is also quite a lot like Hopkins in that she bends words to read on the page as they sound in her head, which in her case does not produce those strange sprung rhythms that Hopkins favored, but the language and cadences and grammar of her Texas childhood, a voice that for me is one of the deepest pleasures of reading her work. That voice, of course, is completely inimitable, but most of us would love to be able to imitate Mary's skill. Not to mention her success. And that's where her new book comes in. The Art of Memoir is a kind of meta-memoir in which she both reflects on how she herself has been able to narrate her own history and offers suggestions for others who would like to try. Like everything she writes, it is wise and useful. But I'm here to tell you that as wonderful as its curriculum is, it is nowhere near as fascinating as the author herself, or I should say the teacher herself. We're very lucky to have her here with us tonight. Please help me welcome Mary Karr.
Thank you. Thank you guys for coming out. I'm the warm-up band, and very proud to warm up for Helen Macdonald. That's a fabulous book. If you haven't read it, you need to rush right out. Writing memoir, if it's done right, I think is knocking yourself out with your own fist. When I was age about 10, I think what qualifies me to write about my memoir, I mean, nobody elected me the boss of memoir. But people have been stupid enough to pay me for it, so whatever. But when I age about 10, in my childhood journal, I wrote, "When I grow up, I will write one half poetry and one half autobiography." It was 1965, I was 10 years old. And I don't even think I think Richard Wright's Black Boy was in the house. I think maybe Helen Keller, I don't know. But there weren't a lot of memoirs, but I think if anything recommends me to write a book about it. It's really just my passion, my ardor for the form. There's something about a single voice crying out of the wilderness of being a human being. I think the most privileged person in this room suffers the torments of the damned, just going about the business of being a human being, that we all get our hearts broken. And so, I don't know, when I was a little girl, I wanted to not be an asshole, is what I aspired, was my goal, obviously. It's an uphill struggle for me. But I didn't know how to kind of grow up. I mean, my house was speckled with bullet holes, and you know, everybody was drank a lot, and because it was Texas, we were well armed. So I'll just read a little bit from this damn book. Let's see what the hell I have to say about it. This is a chapter on voice, I guess. It's funny. The thing I really like about this book, Art of Memoir, available for a pittance in the hallway after, is I think the epigraphs are really good. This is one, the Faulkner epigraph I'm about to read. I believe that when the last ding-dong of doom has clanged and faded from the last worthless rock hanging tideless in the last red and dying evening, that even then, there will be one more sound, that of someone's puny, inexhaustible voice still talking. She says, continuing to talk. Each great memoir lives or dies based 100% on voice. It's the delivery system for the author's experience, the big bandwidth cable that carries in lustrous clarity every pixel of someone's inner and outer experiences. Each voice is cleverly fashioned to highlight a writer's individual talent or way of looking at the world. Every memoirist I know starts off fumbling, jotting down facts, recounting anecdotes. It may take a writer hundreds of rough trial pages for a way of speaking to start to emerge, unique to herself and her experience. But when it does happen, both carnal, physical — by carnal I don't mean sexual, although boning is fun to write about too — both carnal and interior experiences, the life lived in the scene, come back with clarity and the work gains an electrical charge. But for the reader, the voice has to exist from the very first sentence. Because memoir is such a simple form, its events can come across in the worst books as thinly rendered and haphazard. But if the voice has a high enough voltage, it will carry the reader through all manner of assholery and tangent, because it almost magically conjures in her imagination a fully realized human being. We kind of think the voice is the narrator. It certainly helps if the stories you're telling are riveting, but a great voice renders the dullest event remarkable. The secret to any voice goes from a writer finding a tractor beam of truth, of inner truth, about psychological conflicts to shine the way. While an artist consciously constructs a voice, she chooses its elements because they're natural expressions of her own character. So above all, a voice has to sound like the person wielding it, hopefully the supermost interesting version of that person, and grow from her core self. Pretty much all the great memoirists I've ever met, and there are, you know, Maxine Hong Kingston, Tobias Wolff, they all sound on the page exactly like they do in person. If the page is a mask, you rip it off only to find that the writer's features exactly mold to the mask form, with nary a gap between the public and the private self. These writers' voices make you feel close to, almost inside, their owners. Who doesn't halfway consider a fictional narrator like Huck Finn or Scout a pal? The voice should permit a wide range of emotional tones, too wise-ass and it denies pathos, too pathetic and it shrill. Voice isn't just a manner of speaking, it's an operative mindset and way of perceiving. That's why self-awareness is so key. The writer who's lived a fairly unexamined life, someone who has a hard time reconsidering a conflict from another point of view, may not excel at fashioning a voice because her defensiveness stands between her and what she has to say. Also, we naturally tend to superimpose a present self onto who we were before, and that can prevent us from recalling stuff that doesn't match up with our current identities. Or it can warp understanding to fit more comfortable interpretations. You cut a contract early on to offer up the deepest perceptions you can muster without preening and posturing. If the reader intuits some deception or kink in the writer's psyche that he can't admit to, it erodes the scribbler's authority. Richard Wright's Black Boy, published in pre-Civil Rights America, seems to shun charm and speak with a bitterness that the writer paid dearly for. That refusal to pander forms the core of his talent, a ruthless, unblinking gaze that reports to us with often barely tamped down fury. It was Wright, I think, who started the American memoir craze of the last century with the publication of Black Boy in 1945. The book gushed out of him over a two-year period. He was followed closely by other smash hits in a three-year range. Thomas Merton's Seven Story Mountain, Vladimir Nabokov's Speak Memory, Mary McCarthy's Memories of a Catholic Girlhood. The next generation would feature Maya Angelou and Frank Conroy, who no doubt learned from the aforementioned first-timers. Today, I wonder if those early memoirs by Wright, and I'm thinking of the civil rights memoirs that, you know, didn't in some way inspire the civil rights movement. Without them, African-American experience would have been rendered solely in socio-political speak. Wright's refusal to shuffle Uncle Tom-like down the page, trying to call favor, was, at the time he was writing, a revolutionary act. And it reads as true in that context. Of course, his voice can also transport with poetry. Each event spoke with a cryptic tongue, and the moments of living slowly released their coded meanings. There was the wonder I felt when I first saw a brace of mountain-like spotted black and white horses clopping down a dusty road through clouds of powdered clay. There was the delight I caught in seeing long, straight rows of red and green vegetables stretching away to the sun, to the bright horizon. I'm just going to quote a couple of, I'm going to flash forward. A talent for truth includes a voice's bold ability to render events that we find unbelievable elsewhere. On the very first page of Hilary Mantel's Giving Up the Ghost, for my money, a book as worship-worthy as any of Mantel's prize-winning fiction, we hear about her encounters with the spirit world. On the staircase, so this is on the very first page of this book, on the staircase, she passes through a shimmer in the air that contains a ghost. And this is what she has to say about it. I know it is my stepfather's ghost coming down, or to put it in a way acceptable to most people, I know in quotation marks, it is my stepfather's ghost. So she starts by just stating the mystical experience in a simple fact. But because she knows that in our culture we'll adjudge her bonkers, she spends a subsequent sentence traveling to where the reader's more rationalist belief system holds sway. She rephrases, putting the no in quotes. So she starts in her own experience, that mystical truth, then briefly jogs to where the dubious reader is standing there with her arms folded. And from that instant, we trust this most sensible of voices to incorporate both the irrational and our doubt. In doing so, she's invited us into the supernatural experiences so common to her. So later when, as a child in a garden, she has a run-in with the ultimate evil, one could only call it demonic, though she doesn't actually use that word. She doesn't have to disavow the reality of the event to accommodate our doubts. The voice has made room for us earlier. Mantell needs only stick to physical facts and her own child's reaction. So this is a quote. The faintest movement, a ripple, a disturbance of air. I can sense a spiral, a lazy buzzing swirl, like flies, but it is not flies. There is nothing to see, there is nothing to smell, nothing to hear, but it is motion, an insolent shift, and it makes my stomach heave. I can sense at the periphery, the limit of all my senses, the dimensions of the creature. It is as high as a child of two. Its depth is a foot, 15 inches. The air stirs around it invisibly. Invisibly, I am cold and rinsed by nausea. I cannot move. I am shaking. This is the beginning of shame. Whether you doubt Mantell's reality in this passage, you can have no doubt that she's reporting something ineffably real to her. So too must the voice always confess to a reader, to readers, any moral bankruptcy, as Tobias Wolff does in this boy's life. I love the baldness of this passage. I was a liar. I just love that. I mean, you're saying you're a liar and expecting people to believe it. I was a liar. Even though I lived in a place where everyone knew who I was, he's a teenage boy, I couldn't help but try to introduce new versions of myself as my interest changed and as other versions of myself failed to persuade them. I was also a thief. What's so winning about this confession is the author's self-aware reason for it. He explains that he's trying to forge a new self, and when popular opinion interferes with the process, he notes it. He fabricates to fool his audience, and further, what he sees as self-reshaping. It's that gift of self-awareness. Who hasn't wanted to be somebody different and tried to scudge? Even somebody I might not otherwise care for can compel my attention when speaking out of heartfelt experience and self-knowledge. On airplanes, we've all been stranded next to some chatty, perfectly nice, but duller than a rubber knife human being. And we've all faked sleep to escape that chatter. And yet when travelers' anonymity permits that same bore to speak out of some profoundly felt experience, I often find myself riveted by the confessions of someone I'd otherwise dread spending a 5-minute elevator ride with. That same person's living, breathing, honest inner expression, which, when told with heart and candor, includes some parcel of radical suffering or radical joy, well, it always captures me. Speaking from a passionately felt risk event is always risky. Emotional stakes make drama, which is conflict with feeling and danger mysteriously contained in a human body's small space. Don't get me wrong, a writer's voice doesn't have to be effusive or operatic. Nobody's more reticent than Conroy or Nabokov, say. But no one doubts the depths of their feeling, however cool their overall tones. As often as I've been bored by that shallow airplane seat partner, fronting some fake self, I've been transfixed by watching lived passion radiate off a stranger's face. Even the most buttoned up or recalcitrant person trying to restrain feeling can't help but convey it in close proximity if she's telling those core stories that have seemingly shaped who she is. The least articulate of confessors can, in those fleeting moments of connection, move me as a great symphony does. And it's from that need to capture the shared connections between us that symphonies were invented. Ditto memoirs. Thank you.
So, couple of years ago, a British friend called me up and said, "What's your address? I have a book I want to send you." Now I like getting mail from friends as much as the next guy, but I was slightly dubious about this proposition because there are few better examples of bringing coals to Newcastle than sending books to a book critic. But my friend was incredibly insistent. The book in question was not out in the United States yet, and he was desperate to get it in front of me as soon as possible. And sure enough, about a week later, a package from London arrived on my doorstep. Inside that package, of course, was Helen Macdonald's amazing memoir, H is for Hawk. And my friend could not have been more right. I read it in a day and a half, and I promptly started pushing it on all of my friends, which I think might be the surest sign there is of truly exceptional writing. H is for Hawk is partly a grief memoir about the way the death of a loved one can sometimes cause us to temporarily lose traction on the very project of living. It is partly a guidebook to how to train a raptor, should you ever need such a thing. And it is partly a biography of the writer T.H. White, who is best known for his Arthurian epic, The Once and Future King, but also tried to train a raptor of his own, not very successfully, and wrote a wonderful, underrated little book about it, The Goshawk. Helen is going to read some of her poetry, I believe, and also from H is for Hawk tonight, and I don't want to steal her thunder, but I cannot resist sharing just a brief sample of her prose with you. This is from very near the beginning of her book, and it's worth keeping in mind that it's a single sentence. She writes, "Maybe you've glanced out the window and seen there, on the lawn, a bloody great hawk murdering a pigeon, or a blackbird, or a magpie, and it looks the hugest, most impressive piece of wildness you've ever seen, like someone's tipped a snow leopard into your kitchen, and you find it eating the cat." This is the kind of sentence that makes the rest of us decide we are not actually writers. I am in awe of how much work she gets done in it and how beautifully. In just a couple of words, she gets us from the outside world to hearth and home. She gets us from the mundane act of glancing out the window to brutality and loss. And she gets us from that offhand language of the bloody great hawk to that artful and astonishing image of a snow leopard in the kitchen. And along the way, we also learn exactly who we are dealing with, which is an exceptional writer whose interest lies at the borderland between the wild and the domestic, on the relationship between what happens in the outside world and what happens on the inside. These are also central concerns of Helen's poetry and her journalism, which, like her memoir, are simultaneously earthy and intellectually thrilling. In all of her work, she brings a love of science and a wonderfully scientific precision to the imprecise and messy business of being human. We're so lucky to have her here with us tonight. Please welcome Helen Macdonald.
Thank you. Oh my goodness, I'm so English. Introductions like that, I start to sort of squirm. That was so lovely. It's great to be here tonight. Thank you very much to everyone. I'm going to start off by reading some poetry. And I'm going to start off by reading a poem. I used to write a lot of poetry when I was younger, and a lot of it has just come out in a volume called Shaler's Fish in this country. And a lot of them they're pretty comprehensible. I was going full on modernist difficulty when I wrote these poems. But they have the same concerns as a lot of the themes in H is for Hawk. And I want to read one which is basically about military techno-fetishism and becoming invisible. So it's called Have Blue, which those of you who keep up to date with such things and watch the History Channel will know as the code name for the experimental F-117 invisible radar angled plane. So I'm just going to read this and then we'll get on to H is for Hawk. I hope you like it. It's called Have Blue.
Metal grows warmer against the skin. Such implications of expediency call this realism, projected as an interior difficulty, of apprehension blown past as a sere white line over the desert index. A forefinger held up to the sky could see it, but for lack of noise unloaded at night, since the presupposition of a target, costive pitch, and yaw or roll corrected by wire like water falling all around him, with cosine squeals, the line rolled up, and light also fell into it, like wine dark. Seas elsewhere in discs of water and a rapid participatory grace. Elements of predation holding the eye, and not without risk, this grace, a candor tipped to seed darkness with order. An aeolian mat stripped as soft as the image of breath, bronze against bronze, where the cupped hand plenty falls. A fox sparrow shadow on blue stone. Broke diamond, cut cuticle, where rain pools schematics of the calm scintillations of a falling sky and the porous wind of a little country, the steep inklings of the tongue's tip and the implications of a mountain buried in snow. These are lambent philosophies requiring water, new marks to which the mouth is an applied science. So that's the poetry. Oh, no, thank you. Thank you. So the book, yeah, it's all been a bit of a surprise when I wrote this book. I was sort of sitting, swearing and weeping at my desk and eating a lot of pizza and convinced that no one would read it. And I was wrong. I was very wrong. It's been lovely. I've met a lot of extraordinary people over the last couple of years, and I've discovered I'm more of an extrovert than I thought I was, which is also nice. So what I'm going to do here is just basically talk through the story of the book, giving little readings as I go. I'm not going to talk very much about poor T.H. White for reasons of time, but in the Q&A, if you want to talk about him, I'd be delighted to go on and on and on until everyone's very bored with him. So basically, the book starts, actually it was this week, many years ago now, in 2007, the 20th of March, I got this phone call from my mother, and she just said, I had a call from St. Thomas's Hospital, and I knew at that instant that my father had died, and it was grim. You know, he was a very dear friend of mine, as well as being my dad. We were both, I think, nerds or geeks. I don't know what the right term is. Nature geeks. You know, we'd have field guides and go out for walks with binoculars, and we were just good friends. And yeah, after he died, I kind of fell apart a bit, and I started dreaming about goshawks every night. This is not a common sequel to losing a parent. So I just want to read the bit in the book where I explain which particular goshawk I was dreaming about every single night. I used to work at a falconry centre near Wales in Britain, and a wild goshawk, had been hunting and had hit a tree and knocked herself out. They go quite berserk when they're hunting, and they kind of lock on. And it's quite a common cause of death of these birds is to kill themselves by hitting trees. And some lovely woman found this unconscious bird, put it in a box, and then it woke up and she was terrified and obviously decided to give it the problem to someone else. So we wanted to check her over and see if she was okay. We congregated in a darkened room with the box on the table, and the boss reached her gloved left hand inside. A short scuffle, and then out into the gloom, her grey crest raised and her barred chest feathers puffed up into a meringue of aggression and fear, came a huge old female goshawk. Old because her feet were gnarled and dusty, her eyes a deep fiery orange, and she was beautiful. Beautiful like a granite cliff or a thundercloud. She completely filled the room. She had a massive back of sun-bleached grey feathers, was as muscled as a pit bull, and intimidating as hell, even to staff who spent their days tending eagles. So wild and spooky and reptilian. So we sort of felt all her bones to make sure nothing was broken. And we held a finger in front of each eye in turn, and she sort of snap, snap, she went. When I talk about hawks, I'll generally start doing the movements. I'm very sorry about that. I suspect in a few minutes I'll be flapping my arms. You're just hanging out. Then she turned her head to stare right at me, locked her eyes on mine, down her curved black beak, black pupils fixed, and then, right then, it occurred to me that this goshawk was bigger than me and more important, and much, much older, a dinosaur pulled from the Forest of Dean. There was a distinct prehistoric scent to her feathers, and it caught in my nose, peppery and rusty as storm rain. Nothing was wrong with her at all. We took her outside and let her go. She opened her wings and in a second was gone. She disappeared over a hedge slantwise into nothing. It was as if she'd found a rent in the damp Gloucestershire air and slipped through it. That was the moment I kept replaying over and over. That was the recurring dream. From then on, the hawk was inevitable. So this, as a memoir, I mean, I when I first started writing it, I tried to be more English and reserved and not go on about myself quite so much or my emotional states, and it didn't work. It just wouldn't work at all. I kept running against brick walls, and I finally thought, I have to do it. I have to be honest. Readers know when you're not being honest, so. But of all the emotional revelations in this book, the one that makes me still cringe was the bit where I talk about how when I was very small, I was so obsessed with hawks, I used to try and sleep with my arms behind my back like wings. It still makes me cringe. I was quite an obsessive child. You know, my lovely niece, Amy, who's 12, she has obsessions, you know, good ones, Minecraft, Taylor Swift, One Direction, you know, quite sensible ones. Mine was hawks, and all my friends had rock stars on their bedroom walls, and I had pictures of kestrels. You know, and I think my parents were extraordinarily supportive. I told them I was going to be a falcon when I grew up. And I think only twice did my mother very quietly say, "Are you sure you wouldn't rather be a lawyer?" bless her. I became a falconer. I flew many, many birds of prey, peregrine falcons, ger falcons, lots of different things. But there was one bird of prey I never wanted to ever train, and that was a goshawk. They had this reputation. I don't know how to... The other day I was explaining to someone, it was a bit like they're the kind of the Christopher Walken characters of the bird world. They sort of have this sense that they're psychopathic and dangerous and nervous and highly strung and untrustworthy. And I thought, you know, and also bloodthirsty. And I just thought, I don't want to know. And then my father died and they were all I could think about. So I did something which sounds really bad. I bought a goshawk off the internet. It's more complicated. All the birds of prey used in falconry in Britain are captive bred, and I knew the man who'd bred this. He was a lovely guy called Andy from Belfast. So I found myself driving up to Scotland. It's a very long way to Stranraer to meet the ferry and meet this man who had a box with my hawk in. And I'm going to read this bit here. I don't like to go on about, you know, the meaning of the passage I'm going to read, but I wanted to say what I'm doing in this passage is my first sight of my goshawk. I'm trying to explain what she's like and failing over and over and over again because she was honestly indescribably beautiful. And it was like this. Another hinge untied, concentration, infinite caution, daylight irrigating the box. Scratching talons, another thump and another thump. The air turned syrupy and slow, flecked with dust the last few seconds before a battle. And with the last bow pulled free, he reached inside. And amidst a whirring, chaotic clatter of wings and feet and talons and a high-pitched twittering, and it's all happening at once, the man pulls an enormous hawk out of the box. And in a strange coincidence of world and deed, a great flood of sunlight drenches us, and everything is brilliance and fury. The hawk's wings barred and beating, the sharp fingers of her dark-tipped primaries cutting the air, her feathers raised like the scattered quills of a fretful porpentine. Two enormous eyes. My heart jumps sideways. She's a conjuring trick, a reptile, a fallen angel, a griffin from the pages of an illuminated bestiary, something bright and distant like gold falling through water. A broken marionette of wings, legs, and light-splashed feathers. She's wearing jesses, and the man holds them for one awful long moment. She's hanging head downward, wings open like a turkey in a butcher's shop, only her head is turned right way up, and she is seeing more than she has ever seen before in her whole short life. Her world was an aviary no larger than a living room, and then it was a box. But now it is this, and she can see everything. Yeah, it was kind of a weird pickup. Before the man came, I was pacing up and down with a can of soda, caffeinated soda, £800 in my back pocket. I mean, it felt like a drugs deal. And as I drove away with the hawk in the back of the car in the box, I turned back to see the poor breeder surrounded by armed policemen who wanted to know what the hell he was doing. And I just kept driving. I still feel really bad about that. But it was fine. He had the paperwork. It was fine. And then came the great and ancient dance, which is training. And taming and training a bird of prey. I mean, we're talking, falconry is one of the most venerable interspecies relationships that humans have had. We're talking 6,000 years BC, you know, it's incredibly old. And how do you train a hawk? Well, it's done through positive reinforcement, through gifts of steak, This works with people to some extent as well. So I withdrew like a hermit to a darkened room, pulled out the phone cord, this shows how long ago it was, and sat myself down and began this extraordinary process with a bird that was terrified of me. People sometimes say, were you frightened of the bird? I'm like, no, the bird was frightened of me. And started to get it to understand that I was not a monster, but someone who was going to give it presence. And what I was doing was I was trying to distract myself from my grief, and it worked incredibly well. Slowly the bird began to jump to my fist and then fly to my fist in the house, and then we went outside and I called her Mabel. There is a reason for that. Falconers have this traditional kind of thing that if you call a bird something like, you know, Moloch or Slayer or Killer, it will sit on a fence post and squeak at you. But if you call it something cute, it will be a proficient hunter. So I have a friend with a goshawk called Bunty, and I have another friend with a goshawk called Baby Doll, but even he's embarrassed about that and calls her BD for short. And Mabel in Latin means amabilis, it's lovable or dear. And I think looking back on this weird person that was me then, I think it's really strange that I, even though I wanted to cut myself loose from everything that was to do with emotional attachment, I still named my hawk about something to do with love. Then I began to go outside with the hawk and wander around Cambridge. I'm sure many of you have visited Cambridge in England. It's quite an eccentric place, but there are limits. And it turns out that wandering around with the hawk is one of those. It's called carriage, and it's getting the hawk used to all human life, you know, buggies and dogs. And actually, the hawk was quite scared of big dogs, was quite interested in little dogs for other reasons. A lot of small boys used to run past and shout, Harry Potter, at me, which was very annoying. It's not an owl, it's a goshawk. And a couple of times I heard mums and dads say to their children, sotto voce, don't go near the hawk lady. Then there came this extraordinary moment when I'm walking around with her, sort of chilling out, and she's just bored with everything she sees. She's, you know, it's not interesting or salient to her. And then she sees a pigeon coming down to roost in a tree above her. And I just say here, she watches it and time slows, the air thickens, and the hawk is transformed. It's as if all her weapon systems are suddenly engaged, red crosshairs. She stands on her toes and cranes her neck. This flight path, this thing, she thinks, this is fascinating. Some part of my hawk's young brain has just worked something out, and it has everything to do with death. I hadn't really thought it through, had I? I mean, I was trying to escape the raw reality of death, and what I'd done is got myself the most predatory, bloodthirsty bird of prey on the planet. And I knew I would let this bird fly free, and I knew that if she was going to be flying free, she would be hunting, because that's what goshawks do. I say in the book that keeping a goshawk, not letting it hunt, is a bit like having children and saying, yeah, but they're not allowed to play. It's what they're made of. So there's followed these extraordinary months of me going out with this bird of prey and letting her fly across the sort of cloud-scratched, frosty hillsides of Cambridgeshire, and watching her do her thing. And I was very broke, so I was eating the rabbits and pheasants she caught. Obviously, I cooked the bits that I didn't eat them raw. I wasn't quite that feral. I did a lot of poaching. One of the many reasons I'm enjoying being here tonight is it's very unlikely that any local landowners from Cambridge are in the audience who'll want to challenge me about all the pheasants my hawk caught. What was really strange about the experience was that I became a hawk. And that sounds so overblown now, but basically what had happened is when you have a big grief, I'm sure everyone who's experienced this knows, you can't be you anymore. Everything that is you is shattered. You need to rebuild yourself into someone else, someone who can hold that grief within you, yourself, and keep it there. But you're broken for a while. And I didn't want to be me. I wanted to be like this bird. She was solitary, self-possessed, free from grief, pretty powerful thing, and full of life for me. And going out with her and watching her fly and hunt was transporting in ways I hadn't expected. The countryside became a very complicated place, very beautiful. Nothing had a name. I became this feral beast, basically. I was covered in mud and scratches. And I was also really, really doing badly. I used to wake up in the morning and discover that my pillow was wet. I'd been crying all night without realizing why. I was convinced that maybe I had an allergy. I guess it was depression. It was a proper depression caused by me not really coping with my father's loss and distracting myself with this bird. And it wasn't until my father's memorial that I realized I'd made this great mistake, which is to buy into what all the nature books tell you, which is that when you're broken, you go out into the natural world. It's this place of endless solace and renewal, and it will heal you. There's a lot of truth in that, but I took it too far, typically, and I got lost, completely lost. And there's a wonderful bit in the book where I talk about, well, it's not a wonderful bit in the book, but a wonderful thing in the book where I talk about an anthropologist called Rane Villeslev, who talks about the Ukage people in Siberia hunting caribou by assuming upon themselves some part of the caribou's soul. And it works. The caribou come towards you, and then obviously it doesn't end well for those caribou. But the Ukage say that, you know, you have to be careful. If you do it too much, you'll threaten who you are. And that's what happened with me, I think, in many ways. You know, we'll put Freud and Klein and everything to one side. We'll talk about the Ukage caribou hunters. So I went to the doctors, and there was this extraordinary thing where I explained to the doctor that I was pretty depressed. I talked about the fact my father died, that I hadn't got a house, I hadn't got any money. I didn't mention the hawk. I think at that point, I thought we were the same thing, so, you know. And he was extraordinarily helpful. There was this extraordinary, there's this amazing questionnaire that I did. I was very, really open about this situation in the book. And one of the questions, I don't put this in the book, one of the questions was, do you feel you're taking less care of your personal appearance than formerly? And I remember looking at myself, and I hadn't washed my hair for about a month. I was covered in mud, thorn scratches. There was rabbit blood on my trousers. And I was sitting there thinking, I don't know. Do I? Anyway, we crawled back from that place that I'd been that was very beautiful and yet very dark, and I kept flying the bird, but everything had changed, and the world became a warm place again. There was an amazing moment. Every morning I'd get up and I'd look at the sky when I flew the bird, and I'd do that kind of aviator's eye checklist, you know, precipitation, wind direction, is that a cold front coming? And it was all about whether the hawk would have the right conditions to fly. And then one day I looked out of the window, and I caught myself thinking, that looks really beautiful. And I knew that moment that things were going to be okay. So I'm going to just end by reading a little bit from the book about what I learned from Mabel. I think it's very important to realize this is not a book that goes, I was sad, and then I got a cat, and then I was all right again. It was complicated and bewildering and bewitching in equal measure for me. And this is, you know, one of the many lessons that Mabel taught me was that we're not here very long. The borders between life and death are very, very thin. And this. Of all the lessons I've learned in my months with Mabel, this is the greatest of all. That there is a world of things out there, rocks and trees and stones and grass, and all the things that crawl and run and fly. They are all things in themselves, but we make them sensible to us by giving them meanings that shore up our own views of the world. I'd basically use Mabel as a mirror of myself. You know, we do it all the time unconsciously when we look at the natural world. In my time with Mabel, I've learned how you feel more human once you've known, even in your imagination, what it is like to be not. And I have learned, too, the danger that comes in mistaking the wildness that we give a thing for the wildness that animates it. Goshawks are things of death and blood and gore, but they are not excuses for atrocities. Their inhumanity is to be treasured because what they do has nothing to do with us at all. Thank you.
Thanks to both of you for those beautiful readings and comments. Helen, let me start with you. You had been writing poetry before H's for Hawk, and it must be said that poetry is a perfectly respectable and indeed time-honored vessel for grief. And I'm curious about what made you turn to memoir instead, if you sort of knew in advance what form you wanted, or if it kind of got cobbled together over a long time. What was your process like in coming to that?
Why
a memoir? Why the switch?
Well, I was talking with our high school students earlier about this. It's a really interesting question, and I think it's this weird sense I got towards the end of that year that what had happened with me and the hawk was a story, and it was a very old story. It was a story that had happened to lots of people, and was kind of, you know, it's kind of almost mythical, that sense of going off, going away, and then coming back. a trip to the underworld with a hawk by your side. You know, this is kind of almost classical myth. And I thought, you know, hang on a minute, this isn't a story about me, this is a story told through me. And when I wrote poetry, I really liked how difficult it was. I liked being very playful with language. I liked sort of messing around with lexicons and messing around with text, sort of technical terms, and being obscure because it was enjoyable and modernist. And I still like doing that with poetry, but I wanted to just tell the story. And prose was the only way, I guess, to think about that at the time.
Even the most successful living poets tend to be fairly marginal to the life of the culture at large, whereas these days a successful memoirist can become not only incredibly well-known and well-read and popular and a bestseller, but actually achieve almost a kind of guru-like status within the culture. Mary, that's certainly been your experience.
It's not my experience.
All right, let me rephrase that. You might not experience it that way, but it has certainly been the case that your books were received as revelations. They have been, depending on your perspective, credited or blamed with kickstarting an entirely kind of new memoir moment in our culture. And I'm curious what you think about that role and whether your poet self is gratified
true,
or resentful or
if
how that works out.
If that's true, I've been underpaid. And I want everybody to send me a dollar. I don't know. I mean, I sort of feel like at this, you know, in my dotage, that sort of what happens to my work after I do it is kind of none of my business. You know, it's not that we don't want to, as I said earlier, like I'd like to strafe bomb New York City with copies of all my poems and have people run around cleaving them to their breast. But that's probably not going to happen. So to me, though, the interesting part about being a writer is feeling like you're part of this bigger conversation. I mean, what I loved about Helen's book was not just the beautiful sentences and the story, which are both, you know, all of that's beautiful, but that she was in conversation with this great writer, T.H. White, who happens to be one of my favorite writers. And at my best, I kind of forget to feel my ass in the chair. And then there are these other moments where you feel like you're in conversation with people you admire, or that you're, you know, I'm thinking about Richard Wright or Frank Conroy or St. Augustine or somebody you really admire as a writer. So it's like you take your little league slugger into Yankee Stadium and you feel like, I can do, you know, I'm in the house. I'm in the house now.
I can verify that you are in the house now. You are both very much in the house now.
Can I just say something that's just struck me from hearing you tonight? It's interesting to me that both of us at like 10 years old.
Yeah, we both wrote poetry. Mine was clearly
much worse. It's not just that, it's that you wanted to be a hawk and I wanted to be a memoirist. A memoirist poet.
You've been more successful in that particular regard than
I don't know.
It was, I just wanted to.
No, but isn't that interesting that there was.
Wanting to be this other thing.
But there was, it's almost that as children, we had this vision of what we were supposed to do. And then we both went and did all this other bullshit. And then, you know, you went and became a big deal historian and were fancy. And I went and became a sort of slattern of some kind. And then we like went and did the things that we were kind of wanting to do when we were 10.
Yeah.
I mean, that's interesting. Isn't that odd?
Yeah, you think, okay, now, wait a minute.
Isn't that weird?
It is weird. I mean, would that we could compress the time frame between figuring out what we want to do and actually managing to do it. I think that's quite astute. Yeah. I think for a lot of us, there is a kind of moment of clarity in childhood that takes a long time.
But what kept you? I mean, you were training other birds.
Yeah.
And you were reading T.H. White. And you were putting marks on paper.
I was doing all that.
You were doing all those things.
Yeah, I mean,
and then they all converged.
Yeah, this is one of the reasons, personally, it's been really special to me to write this book, because my life has always been kind of half literature and history and kind of that sort of stuff, and half birds and falconry, and they never ever seem to coincide. You know, I always think of those medieval emblems. You know, there's the one that represents the active life. It's a young man on a horse with a hawk in his fist. And then there's the contemplative life. It's always a monk in a cell with a book.
That's us.
That's, yeah. So trying to bring those two together suddenly in this book happened, and that was a... That was a good feeling to try and get it all in one. Of course, it means I feel I'm never going to write another book again, but...
Well, you don't have to now.
Let me ask you about bringing those together, yeah. And it's actually related to what you were saying, too, about who you wind up in conversation with on the page. You didn't talk much about T.H. White in your reading, and so I'm going to give you the chance to do that now. One of the things that's very interesting to me about your work is it's quite unusual to see biography and autobiography combined in the same book. And I am curious, as you were writing those different sections, whether they felt like wildly different modes, whether one informed the other, whether they changed how you wrote about yourself.
Well, it was weird. He was never going to be so much in the book until I went to look through his private papers and unpublished materials at the University of Texas, and I began to get very haunted by him, poring over these huge ledgers that he'd written in this very, luckily, very clear handwriting, thank goodness, otherwise I'd have been, you know, with just stuff in the page, feathers and pictures and portraits.
Little feathers on the actual page,
yeah.
Doesn't that kill you?
And bits where he'd cried onto the page.
And then the tears around the feathers, yeah, that kills me.
He began to haunt me, and then I began to see that the book needed more of him, and for lots of different reasons, partly because I wanted the book to have more than one voice. You know, I had this kind of programmatic feeling about nature writing that it tends to just be generally a singular voice telling you about how the world works. And after bereavement, you don't know how the world works. You know, narratives get smashed and break, and I wanted to get that kind of fracturedness in the book. But also, I wanted to try and see through his eyes, like I saw tried to see through the eyes of a hawk. And that sort of sense that he became woven through my book in the narrative was something that happened. It happened as I wrote. And writing a book, I discovered, was a little bit like wrangling a half-wild animal. It was a bit like messing with a hawk. Some days it would, you know, refuse you to let you do things, and some days you'd be thinking, why am I writing this? You know, and it would all come out. So that sense of a sort of loss of control when I was writing quite often came out when I was writing about White, and that was really exhilarating.
And I know you'd written a proposal, but I assume the book kind of morphed as you.
Oh my God, totally. Yes.
So you would be working on these sections about White, thinking, where the hell is this going to go in this story about the bird? Or
luckily, the sort of arc of hawk training is kind of the same in both our cases. So it was a kind of a ready-made structure to hang it on. So while I was doing something with the hawk, he was trying to do something with the hawk and generally failing. What I didn't want the book to do would be to come across as a book that was like, I could train hawks, you know. This guy, you know, I didn't want
that guy. He was such a shocking drunk. It's a wonder he could do anything.
He was. You know, later in his life, famously, when he lived in Alderney, he had a very palatial house in Alderney. He moved out there because he was very rich from the Sword and the Stone and Camelot, etc. And he became a tax exile. And legendarily, he would have a full glass of brandy in every room so that as he walked around the house, he wouldn't have to look for it.
So you wouldn't have to look for it.
Yeah.
I like the idea that it would be there and you couldn't find it.
Yeah.
Well, after enough of them, you actually can't find them unless they're in a really obvious
place. I remember that.
On the subject of other writers with whom you're in conversation, Mary, I want to ask you about Harry Cruz, and I need to kind of pause before I do that to say, I wanted to anyway, and then it became an irresistible question. I'll let you describe Harry Cruz for the audience, but I had forgotten, if indeed I had ever known, that as it happens, Harry Cruz, who wrote an amazing memoir, which I'll let Mary speak to, also wrote a novel called The Hawk is Dying,
mm-hmm.
about
a
kind of desperate, falling apart life that someone else tries to salvage by writing a hawk. So we're going to let Harry Cruz briefly bring us together thematically tonight. It seemed to me in reading your new book, The Art of Memoir, that Cruz occupied a fairly central role in terms of kind of shaping your own sense of what is possible in prose, what is possible in writing about one's own life, what kind of lives deserve to be written about. And I'm wondering if you can just speak a little bit to his influence on you.
Yeah, I mean, I think I was living in Cambridge and trying to be a poet, and in Cambridge, Massachusetts, whereas Ms. Macdonald was in the original Cambridge, that other place. And so in a way, that's sort of the story of, I grew up in this little backwater. I was a high school, I have no high school diploma. I dropped out of college. I'm completely without any kind of anything to recommend me. And And then you're in Cambridge and you're around all these sort of hyper-educated people, even, and I sort of finagled my way into the academic ghetto there through a series of mishaps and real strivings too, and a real kind of Horatio Alger stick-to-itiveness. And so I would go into Lamont Library and there was a memoir section. I was reading all the memoirs and the Harry Cruse book. I lived in Cambridge 10 years or 13 years, and I was the only person who checked out Childhood Biography of a Place in 13 years, because I would go into Lamont Library and I would check it out. My name was on there like 6 times. And it was this redneck voice, like his book begins, my first memory occurs 10 years before I was born, happens in a place where I've never been and involves my father whom I have never met. And you know immediately he's cutting a deal with you that he's dealing in the realm of apocrypha and family story and family myth. And so he's somebody who's desperately trying to invent himself, and he talks about not wanting to be a redneck. And I mean, his people were sharecroppers. I mean, you know, they were out taking, you know, worms off tobacco leaves. I mean, my people were, it was like living in Paris where I grew up compared to where Harry Cruse grew up. So I mean, you know, my mother subscribed to the New Yorker. It's not exactly the same thing. But to see somebody in love with the idiom that I was in love with, I mean, my father used to say, you know, it's raining like a cow pissing on a flat rock. That's poetry. I mean, if you've never heard a line, I mean, that's as good as Shakespeare. It's an excellent line of poetry. So, like Cruz, I had inherited this idiom from my father, who's actually half Indian, and sort of grew up in this real kind of hillbilly circumstance. So picture me at Harvard College, you know, sort of in this writing group that Seamus Heaney goes to, and trying to write and sound like, I don't know, Little Lord Fauntleroy or something. I don't know who I was trying to sound like. I was probably trying to sound like T.H. White or something. Somebody much more, Macaulay or somebody like that, something really purple. And realizing that what I needed to do was write like I wanted to write when I was in the sixth grade and tell the stories about the people I loved most passionately in the world, and sort of, yeah. So I think I keep a picture of him. You have to picture an English department. If you haven't been to one, good for you. If you have, it's got a lot of, in America, a lot of Emily Dickinson, a lot of Shakespeare, you know, a lot of dead people, mostly. And I have a picture of Harry Cruse, and he's got this, you know, his jean jacket is torn open and he's got this big skull on his bicep. It's like a jailhouse weightlifter. And he's got a line from E.E. Cummings around the skull that says, "What do you think of your blue-eyed boy now, Mr. Death?" You know, so just one way I like to distinguish myself at my university.
At least you can go to a library. Thank you. And look in a memoir section and read your way through it and get a range of voices and start to think about what you want your own to be like and what the possibilities of the form are. Helen, I mean this in the best possible sense, your book is so weird. It's really weird. I read it. I had not read a book that was kind of part natural history, part personal history, part biography, and even that does not quite do justice to the way that it...
Thank you, I think. So,
yes, that's the appropriate response. It really kind of...
It's a good thing.
It's a good thing. It sort of tromps beautifully across sort of genre boundaries in the way I imagine you tromped, possibly illegally, across property boundaries with Mabel. And I'm wondering if you can tell me, did you have influences? Did you have models? Did you read something that made you feel like here's the range of possibility?
Well, okay, so I knew I wanted to have lots of different genres mixed up together. That was always part of the thing, for the same reason about the fact that narratives break and, you know, the stories we tell ourselves about the world, they kind of fall apart when you're grieving, and I wanted to kind of get that across. In terms of influences, I mean, I could
bring out a whole bunch of sort of memoirists. I mean, one of my favorite memoirs is this impossibly beautiful work by Henry Green called Pack My Bag. And it's an amazingly kind of, it's written by an incredibly privileged young man at the start of the Second World War. He went to Eton, and yet it's a book by a man who's convinced he's about to die and he needs to make a reckoning. And the prose is just not like anything else. And I read this book and I thought, he just went for it. He just went for it. He didn't write like anyone else. And I thought, I'm going to try that.
So help me God.
So help me God.
I'll never be hungry again.
Sort of random old Etonian. Yeah, no, I didn't think that. I thought, I was convinced I was going to be broke forever.
Imagine your surprise.
Oh, it has been a bit of a shock, this whole thing. So, but actually, when I was the physical act of writing, I found it very interesting that I couldn't read any literary fiction at all when I was writing, because it was, and I'm sure many writers, it sticks to you. If you read good literature when you're writing, you start writing like the person you're reading. So I listened to a lot of, I read a lot of Agatha Christie and Golden Age detective novels, and I have a sort of worry that part of the narrative drive of my book is just because of that.
Did you read any literary nonfiction?
Nope. I did Agatha Christie, and I listened to Shakespeare plays on the radio. So my book's basically made of those two things.
I can't read fiction while I'm writing because I just will read the fiction instead of writing. It seems self-evidently easier and more pleasurable.
So funny, I can't not read. I don't know, I would be so lonely. I'd be so sad if I weren't reading something. If I weren't reading literary fill in the blank, I would be just, I don't know what I would be doing.
I used to go out bird watching, you see, that's my sad.
That's right, you're actually interested in the world.
That's not traditionally how birders are viewed by the general,
No, but it's true. I mean, that's the world. I mean, it's not like, I'm interested in, I don't know, being at home in my pajamas.
I like that too. Trashy TV is also a great love of mine, but
yes.
I have been handed a series of questions from the audience members, which I'm going to voice for the audience. The first one, I actually need a deeper and more kind of macabre voice than I possess. It is, what do you turn to when you despair?
Start with you. Look at us. We could like the Johnny Cash wardrobe.
Yeah, yeah. I did a talk recently where I was trying to explain to people that I was a very miserable student, and I said, I used to wander around wearing black all the time.
There was this
pause, and everyone, oh, yeah, okay.
You know why women in New York wear black?
I don't know why that. Why is that?
We can't find anything darker.
Okay, go ahead. What do I turn to when I despair? I guess getting older, I guess I just trust in the fact that so far, despair has only lasted a certain amount of time, and then you look up and you see the sky and you think, that's beautiful.
That's such a stoic, such a natural.
Also, toast, overeating, cigarettes, all those other things.
All the other things.
Yeah, trusting in time, yeah.
Mary?
I pray and talk to Jesus. I do. I mean, I know that's funny to most people, but I do. It's Lent. I get to say this. It's Maundy Thursday. But I converted. I was an atheist my whole life, and about 20 years ago, I converted. And someone said to me, well, that just seems like a crutch. And I'm like, well, if you only have one leg.
Good comeback. Good
a crutch comeback. Is not a bad thing to have. I do. I mean, I'm sort of, I ask myself, where is God in this? Like, if you don't believe in God, you could say something like, where is the light? That even in your darkest moments there, and often it involves trying to find something to do for somebody else, which sounds really...
That's true.
I mean, it sounds really stupid, but even just making peanut butter sandwiches, and although I've got to say I was giving my sandwiches out in my little, Mother Teresa thing, and the beggars in New York have standards. I was actually giving out vegan wraps on this occasion, and the guy said, what is it? And I said, it's a vegan wrap, and he's like, I prefer something with an animal in it. I mean, if that's not Jesus talking to me, I don't know what is. It's the funniest shit I've ever heard.
So the audience also has a question specifically for you. Do you need to somehow emotionally fortify yourself or gather forces of support in order to delve into such painful material?
Yes.
If so, how do you do so?
I grew up in a sad house, I'm no Richard Simmons, you know, let's face it. Somebody said to me the other day, weren't you a cheerleader? And I'm like, do I look cheerful to you? I do a whole bunch of things. I mean, I walk around the Central Park Reservoir every day. I do cardio every day. I pray, if I meditate for 30 minutes, I eat green leafy vegetables. You know, I'm also a big fan of the hot bath. I mean, when I pray sometimes, I always say, well, I hear the voice of God. It never says any, there's nothing, no long-term plan. It's always stuff like, put the gun down. <You know? laughs> Don't get on the subway now. No, it's always stuff like, you need a sandwich. You know, or a hot bath. I mean, sometimes the little voice in my head that says, you know, 90% of what's wrong with you can be cured with a hot bath.
I'm going to wrench the figurative mic back from the audience for a minute to ask actually a question about craft, because it occurs to me that the same kind of very practical things that stave off despair, eat a sandwich, take a bath, on some level apply to writing. You can want to be a writer in the abstract, but writing is not an abstract thing. You actually have to sit down and do it. And I'm wondering if each of you could just briefly describe, how do you actually get the work done?
Okay, you have to pretend you're someone who's brave. That's something that took a while to accomplish.
You trained a goshawk.
It's a different kind of bravery. blunt facts, get up in the morning, go straight down to my local cafe, drink as much black coffee as possible, and start working. Now, one of the great things about this was that if you're a writer and you go to cafes, or you start to believe the world is full of people over 60 and young mothers. There's no one else in the world, because everyone else is at work. So I became really good friends with a whole bunch of old kind of rural guys in Newmarket. This is the town I live in England. And Newmarket is not a big reading place. It's the home of British horse racing. The only thing that's read in Newmarket is the Racing Post. And when the book won the Costa Prize, which was, a great surprise, a film crew turned up and filmed my table, much to the consternation of everyone in there. And they ran a kind of competition that if you brought a copy of the book in, you could get a free cake. And I went in the next day.
I
said, did anyone bring it? And they went, anyway, sorry, it's an aside. I used to work until lunchtime and then go back and I'd sleep in the afternoons or go for walks. That was my kind of not writing time. And then at about 6, get up again and just sit there. And as the book
would
went on...
Would you sleep in the afternoon?
Yeah, sleep in the afternoon. Yeah.
For how long?
As long as I could get away.
Well, exactly. But I mean, 45 minutes, 3 hours.
Oh, no, maybe an hour, hour or two.
Really?
Yeah, yeah.
That's
and work,
talent.
And I'd work late. But, you know, there are days when you
then
can't
work from
anything.
6 to...
Till midnight, yeah.
Wow. What a woman.
I swear.
Said that, a lot of that time when I was supposed to be working was me playing Candy Crush or watching YouTube.
Staring out the window.
Yeah, staring out the
a lot
window.
Of make cups of tea. And
yeah, a lot of tea and toast, yeah, yeah.
Right,
that's
right.
All part of the process, yeah. But I think one of the things that I hadn't expected, and I'm sure everyone who's done sort of big projects, are the times when you get stuck. And you feel great despair then, and then you go away and you can't write for 3 or 4 days, but it's working away inside. And it's solving the problems you've set yourself, and eventually you sit down and it works. So I think starting to kind of really realize that actually not working is sometimes a way of working, that was a revelation. Dangerous
one. That sounds like a trick.
Yeah.
That's true, I'm working even now.
We're working right now. I'm cogitating beneath the level of consciousness about my next book.
I know, exactly. Right. Yeah, I also get up early and coffee, and then I move from place to place, which it's when I was living in a bigger house, it was better, but now I have like a one bedroom apartment, so it's sort of sad. I have a walking desk, I have a treadmill desk that gives you that kind of happy hamster wheel feeling. That just kind of Sisyphean, you know, you're just time to make the donuts. You're just walking along. So you do that for a couple hours, and then you move to the living room, and you take your laptop, and you say, I'm not working. I'm just lying on the sofa, and my computer happens to be in my lap. And then you move to the table, and then you take it. Then later in the day, you can take it to the...
It is true. It's quite scary how much you're writing a book involves tricking yourself that you're not really working.
It's
so true.
Well, a lot of times you're not.
Yeah.
I mean,
it's also true.
It's also true. But boy, if I started watching YouTube, I had a rule that Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, I had no social events, and I'd never answered the phone before 3. I mean, if you were dead, you were going to have to stay dead till Thursday.
I love that. But not answering the phone before 3 is such a... It's just
and not getting grand. Online before 3.
Okay.
So it's like just shutting it down for those 3 days. And then Wednesday afternoon or evening, you can have a drink with somebody or you go out or something like that. So then Thursday, you can kind of jack around. And then, you know, you kind of trick yourself that you're...
I should try all of this. You know, one of the funny things about memoir writing is there's so much moral judgment about writing in the first person. And I am curious, as I read it, some of that judgment is gendered, some of it is class-based, there's some sort of objection.
Yeah, nobody says anything about Don DeLillo, you know, appropriating, you know, Lee Harvey Oswald's entire life or J. Edgar Hoover's or anybody else. There's no, you know, I'm always amazed at what people did to Katherine Harrison, and there were memoirists who bombed people's ancestral villages who, you know, nobody really brought to task. So it's interesting.
Do you encounter some of that? It's hard to shed these cultural biases internally, and I'm curious whether you encounter any of that when you're doing your own writing, whether you have to remind yourself you have the authority of your own life, you have the right to tell the story, you have the right to tell your own story, it matters. And or do you have to counter it with audience members and readers and people who get in touch with you? Do you get that kind of blowback for choosing to write about your own life?
Well, I think in my case, it's a book about grief, and one of the things that I think grief does to most people is make them incredibly self-absorbed, because you're struggling to kind of maintain yourself as your identity in some respects. And by virtue of that, my book is incredibly self-absorbed, right? And there have been people who've really taken me to task for that.
Real?
Oh, yeah. I'm the Prozac queen on Amazon, you know. Some really great reviews saying I'm self-absorbed.
Oh, for selfish. Fuck's
but,
sake.
No, but it's really interesting. So I guess what...
So was St. Augustine, you know.
But I do find that interesting, because one of the things that writing the book did was, you know, I couldn't have written it until I started it, which is 5 years after my father's death. I needed to write about someone who wasn't me anymore, and that person in the book isn't me anymore. That person is a character. So I felt when I was writing it that even though I remembered everything that happened that year with really unexpected clarity, I think another effect of grief, I never felt that I was writing about myself in a way. It was someone else that was going through a really weird experience. Mm. And quite often I would be swearing at her at my desk, you know, what were you thinking? So it was a kind of weird doubling going on there. You know, half of me was fixing this character with the same kind of very direct and...
You seemed like somebody in that book, and I want to say this because I think it's true, the better memoirs, who really wanted to know what the hell had happened.
Yeah.
Who really wanted to know what was going on. I never doubted the veracity. I mean, that's the thing about the memoirs you read that are really good. You never doubt. I mean, you read James Fry roostering around, you know, you think, well, this guy's full of horse dookie. But I got the feeling that you were really... You had a flamethrower on your ass.
Yeah, that all happened, yeah. I mean, there are things that are... I mean, there's one thing that I talk about sometimes in discussing the book is that, you know, there was much more contact with my mother and my brother in those months than I talk about in the book. And then I made a conscious decision not to talk about them so much because, I don't know, I just sort of felt they had their own stories to tell. And the book wasn't really about me. It was about grief and about...
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I've been hauled, taken to task for that, you know. But that was a stylistic, you know, decision as much as a formal decision, as much as an emotional one as well.
Have you been the object of that kind of...
Blowback?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Well, nobody's going to induct me into the Academy of American Letters, you know, the American Academy. No memoirist is going to be inducted into, is going to, you know, win a big prize unless it's like, it's a very trashy genre. It's seen as a very, and that was one reason I wanted to write The Art of Memoir, was because there are a lot of great books. Like, I haven't read this guy, what is it, Pack My Bag?
Henry Green, yeah.
Henry Green, I'm dying to read that. But there are a lot of great books, you know, I mean, really, that reward study. Written in the first person, and not just memoir, but, you know, sort of great pieces of journalism, or, you know, I always loved those Antarctic exploring books, you know, the guys, the Shackleton and all those guys.
Off to the Arctic, you know, the face of God in the ice.
Didn't you love all those guys? Yeah, so.
That's a nice segue, and I feel I should give the last question to the audience, and we do only have time for one more.
Supposed to say something.
You are, well, say something, by all means.
People keep asking me online if I'm teaching a class. I am teaching a class this summer from June 20th to 30th in Patmos, Greece.
How terrible for you.
I know, isn't that awful? And I will have like little postcards at the book signing table. But if you want to look online, it's info@goodworldjourneys.com.
Sounds amazing.
Or you can just come to Patmos.
I was going to say, good reason to go to Greece for the summer. Okay. So quickly before we wrap up, there's incredible range and diversity in books that could be counted as memoir. Those include things like Shackleton's voyages. They hark all the way back to Augustine, to Montaigne's essays. You can think about this genre in diverse ways.
Pascal, Marcus Aurelius.
There you go. An audience member asked, and in light of that kind of long tradition, I think it's an interesting question, what kinds of personal narratives, sorry, we're actually asking you guys to be prophets, what kinds of personal narratives will we be reading 20 years from now? Which I take as a nice way to reflect on what are the possibilities of this genre? What would you like to read? What do you hope to see more of? What do you teach your students?
That's a hard one.
I can only think of really snide comments back.
Well, I think you should make some snide comments.
No, I can't. It's an excellent question. I wish I knew the answer.
More voices, more different voices.
More different voices, more different experiences.
Yeah, I think so. I'm, you know, you could read books about my struggle, translated from the Norwegian. Let's have more my struggle.
Although, you know, can I just say about how do you say his word? Nauskar. If there were a woman who wrote a 7-volume book about changing her kids' underpants, do you think, I mean, honest to God, ladies.
It's unlikely.
Do you think if somebody with a vagina wrote one of those books, she would be filleted up and down Madison Avenue? I don't think so, ladies. I don't think so.
So maybe we could have a plea for books being taken seriously of that regard from all sorts of voices, not just...
Well, no, I mean, I like the first couple of those, and then I begin to, you know, it does wear thin.
You set out for snide, and we actually wound up somewhere incredibly earnest, which is a plea for more voices and more receptivity to those voices in the genre of memoir, which strikes me as a lovely way to end. Thank you both so very much for your time.
Thank you.